All right, well, we've got the message somewhere in this book, amen. Genesis to Revelation, as long as we stay in the Bible, we'll have the right message, amen. I left here Friday and prayed all the way to the house, been praying ever since I left, and preached all day Sunday two times, and just kind of seeking the will of God. It's nothing new to be preached, amen. I'm not looking for anything new, and I think everything you heard last week, you've heard it before. It's not that we're looking at a new message, we just need to respond to the message. Get it right, amen, get it right. And I'm glad this sister's already confessed tonight. That's starting a revival, confessing. So no matter how big a mouth was, confessing, that's good, amen. So we get started out right, confessing, amen. If you will, I want you to find two places. If you will, Deuteronomy chapter 21, also Luke chapter number 15. Luke chapter number 15, I'm going to start reading in Luke chapter number 15, if you will. Very familiar, but we say that, we ought to be able to say that about any scripture, amen. Read the Bible, study the Bible, dear God, most folks a lifetime, we ought to be able to say that about the whole Bible, amen. Be familiar with the scripture, so don't let it rob you of the blessing that God wants to give us tonight. Luke chapter number 15, verse number 1. Then drew near unto him all the publicans and sinners for to hear him. Be a good thing for us to hear him tonight. And the Pharisees and scribes murmured, saying, this man receiveth sinners and eateth with them. And he spake this parable unto them, saying, what man of you, having 100 sheep, if he lose one of them, doth not leave the 99 in the wilderness, go after that which is lost until he find it? And when he hath found it, he layeth it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he cometh home, he calleth together his friends and neighbors, saying unto them, rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep which was lost. I say unto you that likewise a joy shall be in heaven over one sinner that repenteth, more than over 99 just persons which need no repentance. Either what woman having 10 pieces of silver, if she lose one piece, doth not light a candle and sweep the house and seek diligently till she find it? When she hath found it, she calleth her friends and her neighbors together, saying, rejoice with me, for I have found the peace which I had lost. Likewise, I say unto you, there's joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner that repenteth. And he said, a certain man had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me. And he divideth unto them his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together, I took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance in riotous living. And when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and I sent to him into his fields to feed the swine. And he would fain have filled his belly with the husks that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. And when he came to himself, he said, how many house servants of my fathers have bread enough how to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father, and will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee, am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. And he arose and came to his father, but when he was a great way off, his father saw him, had compassion, and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven, and in thy sight am no more worthy to be called thy son. But the father said to his servants, bring forth the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet. And bring hither the fatted calf and kill it. Let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to be merry. If you will, pray with me and for me tonight. That God will help us. Father, I sure love you. I thank you, dear God, for loving us and being so good to us. Thank you for safe traveling, mercy and grace. Thank you for these that have been faithful to assemble themselves together here once again. God, as we open the Word of God, I beg you tonight, Lord, you'd open the scripture, open our hearts, open our minds, I pray we'll be receptive to the word of God. Give us unction, power, liberty. God, empty me of myself and fill me, control me by the Spirit of God. Help me to say what you'd have me to say to your Lord. Help me not to say anything contrary to your will, how your word or your way. I beg you, dear God, as a preacher, the man of God, has been asking today, I pray you put the devil at bay. How, dear God, I pray, Lord, you rebuke the imps of hell. Oh, dear God, I pray today, Lord, you'd give us liberty. Help us as your youngins to be able to put our feet on the table tonight. Oh, dear God, we can rejoice because the names are written in heaven tonight. Oh, dear Lord, we claim victory tonight, God, through the lovely name of Jesus. I beg you tonight, God, if there's one who lost and undone, that gets saved, but help the saints tonight. I pray, dear God, we'll see where we're at. Lord, pull up real close to you. Get real revival, dear Lord, in our souls and our hearts. Lord, help our minds tonight. How to be set affections on things above. Our Lord, help us to preach as a dying man. How to dying people, help us to respond right, dear God. As if this would be the last night we'd ever be on. Our dear God, on this side of eternity, Lord. If there's anything wrong in our lives, we'd make it right. Before we leave this place tonight. We sure do love you now, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated tonight. I believe as we come to Luke chapter 15 tonight, I believe we enter the very heartbeat of heaven tonight. We enter to the heart of Luke's gospel here as he gives the heartbeat of heaven when it deals with the salvation of lost humanity. When I look at the lost sheep tonight, that sheep is lost because it wandered astray. I look at the lost silver tonight. It's out of circulation because of a certain fall. A sudden fall. And then we see the lost son. He's lost because of rebellion. Because of pride, self-will. A decision he made. And so he's lost. When I look at the lost sheep tonight, he's not strong. He's not swift. He's not even smart. But somewhat stupid. I look at the silver tonight. It's lost, but it's not aware that it's lost. The woman is aware that it's lost. I think about the lost son. He deliberately walked away from the father. He's lost because he chooses to be lost. I look at the sheep tonight. It's in a distance. It's in a distance tonight because he's dumb. A sheep is dumb. It's defenseless. It cannot defend itself. He's so dumb he can't find himself back to the house. That's how dumb he is. I think about the silver. It's lost in the dust. It's dead. It's nothing but dead. It's in the dust. It's in dirt. It's in darkness. It's in dust tonight. I think about the lost son. He's out because of rebellion, disobedience. He's disobedient. And so he is a disgrace because of his disobedience. I look at the sheep tonight. We could preach a while. I'm thinking about the sheep. I picture the folks that are lost in this world all around us. I come to the silver tonight. I think about those that are lost. Even in the church house. Then we come on down to the sign. We can see those that are even lost in the family tonight. We could preach much about all that. But I want to report to you tonight. There is hope for, thank God. Thank God for the sheep. There's hope for the silver and hope for the son. Amen. I'm glad God loves us tonight. When we look at this chapter tonight, we see the Godhead at work. Amen. Ain't you glad tonight at lost sheep? I'm glad the Holy Son of God come down to seek and to save that which is lost. I didn't go looking for God, but I'm glad he came looking for me. Amen. He takes the sheep, the Bible says, and puts it on his shoulder. Puts his head up close to his breast, amen, and takes him to the house. I think about the silver. I'm glad the Holy Ghost came by one night and swept around in my house, amen, and turned the light on that I could get saved by the grace of God. I think about the lost son. I thank God for the Father, amen, for his love tonight. And so we look tonight, the son, thank God he's pursuing the sheep. I think about how the Spirit is procuring. Thank God he's getting the silver. I think about the parting of the Father. Listen, if we don't get pardoned, we'll die and go to hell, friend. And so I thank God for that. And so the Son is looking, how the Spirit is laboring. And I'm glad, thank God, the Father's loving tonight, amen. And as we look at this tonight, how the silver didn't go looking for the woman, but the woman's looking for the silver, amen. Now when we look at this tonight, we see the Godhead at work. God sent his Son. He sent His Spirit. He sent His Scripture. But then we come to the place that we look at this Son tonight. We see the free will of man. God's not going to make anybody get saved. It's not a such thing as irresistible grace. Here's the Father stayed at the house. He didn't go out the Son, friend. I'm going to look at this tonight. When the Son repented, the Bible said the Father met Him halfway. He was looking for Him. And so God is the one that takes the initiative for salvation. He sent His Son, sent His Spirit, and gave us the Scripture. But you can go to hell if you want to, if that's your choice. He gave us a free will. He gave us a choice, amen, that we could choose tonight. And so listen, even as a child of God tonight, even as a child of God, I know this Scripture all the way through there, how all this deals with lost things. Lost sheep, lost silver, and lost son. But even after you're saved by the grace of God, how you live every day making choices and decisions. And you know, even as a saint of God, you can choose to go to the hog lot if you want to. But there's always consequences that come with it tonight. And so tonight, I want to take a little while tonight. And look at this son, if we could. If you will, don't you look at verse 12 tonight. In verse number 12. And the young of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that followed to me. And he divided unto them his living. Tonight, I want to give you several things. I hope you listen real good. Here's a young man that is desirous. They're mastering him. All of a sudden, his desire. He's making a request here. You know, a lot of people today, they want what God can give them. They don't want God, though. They don't want God to control their life, be their savior, be their master. They want to walk on God's green earth. They want God to send the rain, the sun, help grow crops, give them food, give them a good job, a good place to eat. They want all these things, but they don't want to God. They want what He has. He makes a request. He said, I want you to give me. A lot of selfish requests go on, even around the church house, friend. He's making a selfish request tonight. He's self-willed. He's on a one-way street. He's wanting everything to come his way. It's all about himself tonight. I'm going to look at this tonight. Here's a young man wants more. He wants more popularity. He wants more possession. He wants more property. He wants more money, more parties. Maybe he wants a whole lot more. He wants more excitement. He wants pleasure. He wants sin. He wants immorality. He wants all these things. And it's a picture of our generation today. Oh, when you look around our generation, the true desires that are in the heart of people is mastering them. What's on the inside will show up on the outside eventually. And here's a young man that's got some desires that's mastering his life. Now, there's a whole lot of people, and it's more today than I've ever seen in my life, that you go out on visitation. You talk to people down the street, at the gas station, wherever you go. As a whole lot of people say with their lips now. You used to not hear this junk. A whole lot of them say with their lips now, more than I've ever heard in my lifetime, that they're atheists. They say they're atheists. They don't believe in God. But it's more people today, I say it with their lives, than they do with their lips. A whole lot of people go to church. They may not say there's no God with their lips, but their lives, they live just like how God don't exist. They want what God can give them, but they don't want to give back. They want to be a servant to the Lord, amen. And so here's a person, he's living his life just like how God don't exist. He's living selfish, friend. And listen, he's sincere. He wanted happiness. Everybody wants to be happy, but they're going to the wrong places to be happy. I don't find nowhere in the Bible God wants me to be happy. God wants me to be holy, amen. And thank God if we'd be holy, we'd be joyful, rejoicing in Jesus. We got something to rejoice about for all time and eternity. It ain't got to be because everything's going well. It's because your soul has been saved from hell, friend. Your name's been written down in the Lamb's Book of Life. That's enough to rejoice about. Out throughout eternity, said, we're not to rejoice because the demons are subject, but because my name is written somewhere. And so the Bible tells us here, here's a young man. He's selfish and sincere. You can be sincere and be wrong. and be out of the will of God. The Bible said there's a way that seemeth right unto man. But the end is what he said. That's what we're interested in, is the end have of the ways of death, friend. And so no doubt, here's a person here is also a stubborn person. I believe with all my heart. Here's a father loved his son enough. He sat him down, talked to him. He tried to keep him at the house. He didn't want him to leave. He didn't want him to go out to the hog lot. He didn't want him to leave from home out where daddy could take care of him, but out of stubborn now. And so listen, God gives us a free will. Whether you're saved or whether you're lost, you still got a choice. You still got a will.
Right. Yeah.
God ain't gonna force salvation on us, and he sure ain't gonna force revival on us, amen. But he sure will give you salvation if your will will meet his will. He sure will give revival if my will will meet the will of God. He's willing to do that. And so we see his request. Let's build a little bit more. Stay with me now. Look at verse number 13. Notice this now. We see his rebellion. The Bible says, and not many days after the young are gathered all together and took his journey into the far country, and there wasted his substance in riotous living. I see he's in rebellion. He's disobedient. He's gone to the far country. Our folks always talk about the far country. It's not measured in miles. It's measured in morals. Is that right or not? I'm going to think about him. It's a picture of those that opposed to God's will. Our folks are living opposed to God's will. The best thing I can do is get in God's will. I find the will of God. That's a lot of people saying today. They don't even believe you can know the perfect will of God. Everybody will live in the permissive will of God. And friend, you can live in the permissive will of God all your life and miss the perfect will of God. I want to be in the will of God, amen. I want to be where God wants me to be, when he wants me to be there, how he wants me to be there. I'm saying what he wants me to say. I'm doing what he wants me to do, thank God. I want to be in the umbrella protection of God. I want to be protected by the Father. And here's the boy that's got rebellion. We got a lot of folks in church tonight. Let's just be honest. We'd have a whole lot greater revival last week if folks hadn't been rebellious to the Spirit of God. I heard somebody on radio today, I was coming up the road, I'm begging God to move. Amen. You ain't got to beg the Holy Spirit to work. He's been working ever since he come back. He ain't lazy for him. He's doing his job. The problem is we ain't listening too good and ain't responding right. Huh? Amen. Notice something now. Stay with me. Look at verse 13 again. And not many days after the youngest son gathered all together, took his journey to a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. And when he had spent all, there rose a mighty famine in the land, and he began to be in want. But I'm telling you, we got a famine today. We're in want. I'm telling you, we got a famine. Notice what it said now. The Bible said in verse 15, and he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his field to feed swine. And he would have fain have filled his belly with husk that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. Now listen tonight. We see here not only the desires that mastered this young man, but we all of a sudden now see the disasters that met it. We got folks in the churches tonight. They're in a mess. They got all kind of dilemmas. They got all kind of disasters going on. And a whole lot is because they failed to do what God asked them to do. They stepped out of the will of God. Here's a young man lost all of his wealth. It cost him everything. He lost everything he had. About being rebellious and disobedient to the Father. He even lost his way. Let me say something tonight. The devil never comes in here and takes a preacher off the front row of a pew or out of a pulpit and curses him right, just throws him out. No, it's little by little. It starts in the head. It gets in the mind. Our folks come to church, you see them up here like he's got. They're shouting and praising God. If there's members of your church, they start getting a little backwards and bent out of shape about something, all of a sudden they'll sit back yonder. They'll say, well, I'm just trying somewhere else. I want to sit somewhere else. Then next thing you know, in the back, they miss Sunday night, they start missing Wednesday night. You can mark it down, friend. It's just little by little. And we got folks in our churches just little by little. That's been led away from the house of God, the power of God, and going out to the world, to the hog lot, and getting all saturated. And there's some disasters waiting some folks. They go to our church. They've lost their way. They got on the journey. What is the journey? Any direction you take away from God, it's a downward journey, friend. And here's the young man. They took a journey, and the Bible said he joined up. And with that crap, we got a lot of people yoking up with worldly folks today. You're getting so you can't tell the church from the world. Because there's a joining going up. They took a journey that way. They joined up and jobs. Oh, dear God, help me not to be. Oh, dear Lord. We got folks, they look like they look a job to miss church. I got saved, amen. I worked one Sunday. I was down on my knees on a Sunday. I was down there cutting a block, laid down there. And it's just like God tapped on my heart. I told that old fella, I said, I'm going to finish the day out. I said, but I'll never work again on Sunday. If I starve to death, and I won't, amen, I'll never work again. So if that means I don't have a job, I won't be back. But I'm going to the house of God on Sunday, amen. And amen, I've kept true to that. And God's met all my needs and plus some, amen. And so we look for job. Here's a young man got a job he shouldn't have never had. We got a lot of young folks got jobs they shouldn't have never had. And it's taking him out of the house of God. Is that right or not? And you know I'm telling it right tonight. And so here it is. He's got a job. He's lost his worth. He's at the bottom of the barrel, friend. He's as low as he can go. I think sometimes we got to get about that far before we'll ever have real revival. Got to get about as low as we can go at the bottom of the barrel. He's in the hog lot. He's in the hog pen. That means he's out in the world as far as a person can go. There's folks who used to come to this church out of town. Used to go to my church out of town. Used to go to some of these other churches out of town. In the hog lot. We need a real revival, thank God. The kind that the Holy Spirit will draw them back, amen. I can know there's a place they can get some help. That's some hope. Now look at verse 13 again. Stay with me now. He wasted his substance with righteous living, verse 14. And when he spent all, there arose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want. Here's a young man, all of his resources are long gone. I've had folks come to church, get out of the will of God. Get out of the will of God and about lose everything they got. Sometimes they did. Then they come back to church, want some help, you help them. Want you to pray about getting a job. They get a job and they blow it again. I'm not being mean. I'm just telling like it is. All of his resources are long gone. If he'd have used them to bless the Father with, amen, it would have multiplied. God would have blessed him. But his resources are gone. I think about people today, their health. A lot of people are wasting their health. He lived a wasted life. He blew his health, friend. We got folks, and I'm not being mean, but preachers used to preach the Bible. They used to preach against sin. How things that would harm the temple of the Holy Ghost. It's a disgrace. Yeah, folks come to church, they can't even hear our preaching. That they don't slide out the back door and slip out to the vehicle or somewhere and suck on a pipe or some kind of electronic cigarette or smoke one or something. You know what I'm talking about? They're so out of control. That's something else. I buried a brother. I hate him with all I got. I buried a brother 53 years old. They told him when he was in his 20s and 30s, if he'd throw him away, he might live a little longer. But messed his heart up and died. I buried a sister 60 years old because the doctors get him on pain medication and messed the health up, friend. And so listen, I'm against anything that'll tear down the temple, friend. And here's the young man wasting his health. We got health tonight. Why don't we use what we got? I could go out and tell others about Christ. Ought to be beating on doors all weekend. I'm praying and crying, inviting people to come to the house of God and praying over the soul. He wasted what he had. All of a sudden the funds has run out. He's a penniless man. All of a sudden his friends have taken off. His friends are gone. You mark her down. When you got the money, you'll have it, crowd. When you lose the money, they'll lose you, friend. And all of a sudden the famine moves in and he's in a hopeless situation. The devil is dangling out. I bait to our young people today. Offered him all kind of pleasure. There is sin and pleasure. Just for a season. Sin will take you further than you ever want to go, and you know this story. Keep you longer than you want to stand, cost you more than you want to pay. That's what sin's doing to a lot of folks. Now look at verse 14. The Bible said he lived in want. He spent all he had. He began to be in want. He's got a want. He's living in want. Let me say something about the sinful nature of man. Here's a man living in depression. And listen, friend, depression is just as real as back trouble. It's just as real as heart disease. I don't belittle that, friend. But either you're going to leave your wealth or it's going to leave you one day. All of a sudden, his wealth has left him because of his sinful nature. He's living in disgrace. He's in the hog pen. He's living like an animal. We got folks today living like animals. struggles. I'm living in dissatisfaction. You can put a mask on all you want to and try to act like everything's all right, but everybody's got a vacuum inside of them. And the only thing can fill that void and that vacuum is the Holy Spirit of God. God made us that way when He breathed the breath of life into man. There's a void there. Unless God fills that void, you can search this world over and try everything it has to offer, but you'll never find anything that'll satisfy and bring satisfaction in this world that we're living in tonight. That's what we're living in. Well, now look at verse 15 real quick. He went and joined himself to the citizen of that country, and he sent him into the field to feed swine. And he would have fain filled his belly with the husk that the swine did eat, and the man gave unto him. No man gave unto him. He went there, and watch this now. He gladly would have filled himself with the husk. Those, that stuff that's just a kernel, just appealing. Just the outside substance, friend. No real substance about it. Nothing inward, no inward reality. We got folks tonight have reduced themselves. They have lowered themselves so low. God don't want me to walk down. I thank God in this world and get as close as I can. I'm living in sin. Here's a young man, friend, has reduced himself. He's lowered all of his standard. He's compromised. And it's got him to the bottom of the barrel. We got folks today just living a life of emptiness. They got liquor, but they're still empty. They're drinking more, but it's not bringing satisfaction. There's sex all in your face everywhere you go. We got all kind of perversion going on. Man, a try fornication. Then that gets short, don't satisfy. And then it goes to adultery. And then it goes to sodomy. We got all kind of stuff going on. Folks are trying to find something how to satisfy, but it never will, friend. And listen, here's we got folks today on drugs. Everywhere you look around, folks are messed up on dope today. I think about how much dead religion we got. No wonder folks don't go to church no more. They go to church, there's a lot of deadheads at the house of God. I don't have any life about them. You in love with somebody, it'll show up, amen. It'll show up in your face, and your walk, and your talk, and the way you live, if you love somebody. And here's a young man that's brought some disasters in his life. Now, let me ask you something tonight. What kind of decisions you got going on that's mastering you? If you're not careful, if you miss it and make the wrong decision, there'll be a disaster waiting. Now come on back up here now. Here's where I want to get to and bogged down a minute. Verse 17. When he came to himself, good day. Came to himself and he said, how many hired servants of my father's have bread enough? I'm glad he's got enough bread. He got enough bread, amen. Now notice what it says now. Listen, he said, how many of my hired servants got bread? Look what he says now, if you will, verse 17. He said, have bread enough and spare, and I perish with hunger. I will arise and go to my father and will say unto him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and before thee, and no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. Amen. And so I want to talk a little while tonight if we can. I preached just a little bit on this. I'm going to get this place right here. Here's a young man made a decision that messed up his life. He wasted everything he had. He ruined his life, wasted his life. But then he had some disasters to come and meet him. But some folks got to have disasters to get them to the place that to call on God. There are some discoveries that are made from verse 17 down to verse 24. I think we'll look at. First of all, he finds out what kind of failure he was. He finally reached to the bottom of where he was. I thank God, listen, it turned him back to the Father. I've got some family members I've been praying for and praying for years, and we have to be very careful. But I'd rather see him hit the bottom down here and somehow or another caused him to turn and repent of their sin and cry out for help than have all this world has to offer like that rich man and die and wind up in hell, friend. And so we need to be praying. Here's a young man. I realized the failure he was. He thought he was a wise man. We got a whole lot of young folks today think they're wise, but they're fools. They're living the life of a fool. Here's a young man thought he was strong, but you go down to the hog lot and see how weak he is, friend. We're no match for the world, the flesh, or the devil. And here's a young man that's at the bottom, friend. He thought it'd bring happiness. There's young little girls that young night in crack houses, out there in dope houses. They thought they'd find something to satisfy and make them happy, but they're living a life of misery. You go up and down these streets, you hardly ever find a young person, an older person anymore that's got a glow about them, got love about them. Now, folks are miserable everywhere you go, friend. How they're miserable at school. They're miserable at the church. They're miserable at home. Thank God if there's one place we ought to be able to come and let our hair down. Thank God we ought to be able to come meet here. We ought to already been met with him throughout the week, amen, and be able to come to the house of God. I get away from the hell of this world and put our feet on the table and bask in the love of God, amen. Here's a young man wasting his life. I don't want to waste my life. He started out with gimme. Everybody saying, God, gimme, gimme. Now, what we need to do in this revival this week is don't ask God to give me anything. Let's come this week and say, God, make me. Dear God, make me what you'd have me to be. I don't want you to give me nothing. I'm not going to ask him for nothing this week. I'm going to ask him all week to make me. Dear God, mold me and make me. I want you to have me to be. Here's a young man. I thought he needed God to give him something to make him happy. No, what he needed was I've got to make him, amen, where he could be happy. God can make something out of us if we let him. Even in our dirty, lost condition, he took a little shepherd boy and made him a king. Thank God took a little Jewish girl and made her a queen. Thank God, I think about all that God done could take a cursing fisherman and make him a preacher man. I think about Rahab the harlot. I would have rode her off. We wouldn't have went to visit her. But I'm glad he paid her visit, amen. Gave her a word, saved her by the grace of God, and put in his own genealogy, amen. I think about that Gadarene. Over yonder on the other side, everybody didn't give up. They tried. We got to give them credit. They tried. They bind him. They done everything they could to tame him and tie him down, but they couldn't. But I'm glad one day there was one came across the water, thank God, and stepped over on his side and made a new creature out of him. Amen. I ain't got a new creature in Christ. He ain't running around naked anymore, cutting himself. He's got his clothes on, seat at the feet of Jesus in his right mind. I'm glad God can put you in your right mind. You may have to go to the hog lot before God can deal with your mind. You may have to go to the graveyard and mess your life up enough. But God knows how to show up, amen, and when to show up to fix the problem. I'm tired, thank God, of the peelings we have. I want to say God's got a saving nature. I thank God for the Son in the rescuing business, in the delivering business, amen. I'm glad he's a seeking and a saving. That which is lost, I think about the Spirit in the revealing business. If he hadn't revealed to me that I was down in the dust, down in the dark, I'd have never known. I'm glad one night he turned the light on. He turned the light on the gable into my soul. I saw where I was at. I was in the dust. I was dead in my trespasses and sins. On my way to hell. But thank God when he turned the light on. I said, I like the light down the dark. Here, God, keep the light on, amen. He ain't turned the light off since, amen. When I agreed with him how lost I was, the light's been turned on. I think about tonight, thank God, the receiving of the Father. I'm glad he'll receive you tonight if you come to him. Whether you're son and you need help tonight, I'm glad God's waiting. Verse number 20, stay with me now. And he arose, came to his father. Ain't that what we're trying to do this week? Is that what we're going to do this week? I'm going to come to my father. Well, I ain't going to ask you for nothing this week. Dear God, don't you take me and make me what you'd have me to be. Come to his father. Look at verse 20, stay with me now. Watch what he said. But when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him. Now, why do you reckon he saw him? Because he's looking for him. Amen. God the Father's looking for you this week. He's already sent his son. He's already sent the Spirit. He's already sent his scripture. Amen. Now he's just waiting for you to come. Amen. And look what he said in verse 20. But when he saw him a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion. Amen.
They've got the only way we're going to have revival is we ought to have some compassion from the Father. Amen. It ain't because we've worked for it. It ain't because we earned it. It ain't because we deserve it. It's because of who He is. Amen. How much He loves us. He had compassion. He ran and fell on his neck and he kissed him. Will you listen to me just a moment? Go to Deuteronomy chapter 21. You should already have that marked. Deuteronomy chapter number 21. If you will, turn there, please. Verse number 18. If a man have a stubborn and rebellious son, which will not obey the voice of his father or the voice of his mother, that when they have chastened him and will not hearken unto them, then shall his father and his mother lay hold on him and bring him out unto the elders of the city, unto the gate of the place. And they shall say unto the elders of the city, this our son is stubborn and rebellious and will not obey our voice. He is a glutton and a drunkard. And all the men of the city shall stone him with stones that he died. So shall they put away evil from among you. And all Israel shall hear and fear. Here's a young man that's been disobedient to the Father. He's been rebellious. He's lived in righteous living. He's got so low, ain't nobody else to turn to, friend. It's either the Father accept me or die. And I believe this. I don't know what you believe. But I believe the day when that Father gave that boy what that boy said, Father, I want you to give me what's mine. It was just like saying, I don't care if you're dead. I don't care if you die. Our folks today said, God, if you just give it all to us, we don't care if you're dead, friend. And so that day when he left, he walked away. No doubt it broke that father's heart. But I believe some things went on that day. I believe when they went to the supper table that night, I believe daddy said, go on, set the plate down. We ain't going to give up on that boy. We're going to pray every time we eat. We're going to pray every time we go to bed. We ain't going to give up on him. And I believe he said, listen, as you go out, John, that little old calf is just born. I want you to put that calf up. We're going to stall feed that calf. I don't know what you think about it, but maybe he even named that calf the name of his son, that every day he'd walk out to the barn and look at that calf and talk to that calf just like he's one of his own children, friend. And said, I got a boy out, Chanda. When he comes back to the house, we're going to have a feast. You're going to be the feast. And no doubt he looked every morning when he got up. Thank God, I believe he came out before breakfast and looked down the road looking for that boy to come out. I believe we ought to pray, believe in God. Amen. I believe we pray for revival. Thank God, look for it. I believe we'd run smack into it. Amen. God will send it down the aisle. He'll send it in the pew, send it in your heart. And that is fine. Father's looking in the morning. Don't see him. He goes to the field. Every time he looks around, he's looking the way that he left. He's looking for that boy. Every night before he's going out to dinner table, supper table, he looks down the road. I probably sat there and rocks a little while, holding his wife's hand, said, honey, we're going to believe God. He'll come back. We ain't going to give up on him. He'll come back. Just set the plate, amen. Set the plate. Get that best robe I got going. Get it cleaned up. And God put the paper on it. We're going to have everything waiting. He's looking for him, amen. The Bible, somebody saw him a great far way off. The Bible said he ran. You know why? That old boys are coming home. He's just gone as low as he can go. He's hit the bottom of the barrel. He smells like a hog pen. He don't even have shoes anymore. That's how low he's gone. His feet's dirty and bleeding. But listen, it ain't because he didn't look the same when I come back when he left, but it's something about the way he walks. Daddy had been watching him a long time. It's just something about he's looking for him. And he said, that's my boy. And so that boy knew the law. Law says, you've been rebellious. You brought shame on mom and daddy. You deserve to die. You deserve to die. When fathers are looking for him, he saw that boy. The Bible said he ran. Thank God he met him. That old boy's already got his repentance in his heart. He's headed back to the house. And so the first thing that boy does, when he sees father coming, no doubt the servants, I saw him running. Amen. Hallelujah, thank God. They start running out of the fields. They see the excitement in daddy. Running toward that boy. That boy thought surely they're coming with a bag of rocks. And he fell to the ground. He knew the law. Stretch your neck out and lay it on the ground. They're going to put their foot on your neck and pronounce a curse on you. And they're going to stone you to death. But oh, hallelujah. Thank God. I'm glad God's in the reconciliation business. He didn't feel a foot on his neck, amen, and condemnation and judgment under the law. But thank God he got smooched by God. God started kissing on his neck and kissing on his neck and kissing on his neck. I say hallelujah. Let's run toward him this week. Let's run toward God this week. And God, he ain't got a foot waiting to put on your neck. I'm glad it's got some kisses waiting. A reconciliation at the house of God. So thank God the Father's that. The Father's forgiveness. The kiss, amen. I forgive you. That night I went to that altar. That's a lost, low down, rotten sinner. I felt love that night. I never felt. Thank God, listen. Somebody, it wasn't no preacher, didn't nobody take a Bible. I thank God for the Holy Ghost. Sometime it ain't a preacher around. It ain't a written word around. Now I'm glad the Holy Spirit, the one that walked by and turned the light on. I thank God when I bowed down, poured my heart out. I believe he'd already done it back yonder. When my will met his will, I was running toward him. He was already leaning in my direction. I run into him. He run into me, thank God. And he loved on me, and he's still loving on me, amen. Thank God, I'm glad tonight, amen. The Lord's got a kiss of reconciliation. He's a kissing on that boy. Instead of putting his foot on his neck, he's a loving on him. Thank God, hog like the whole, amen. He brought it to the house, and he loving on that boy, amen. Yes, amen. The Father's favor, a robe of rulership, robe of rulership. Joseph had a robe. I didn't know all I got tonight. I got saved. Thank God I got a robe. It wasn't a black jacket. Thank God I'm glad I got a robe of righteousness, amen. There's a line the devil can't cross, amen. I'm one of his, amen. He's first in rank in the family. I thank God he's got a robe. What about the father's finances? He said, bring the ring. I know he wasted what I gave him, but now he can have it all. Amen. We blew it the first time, but thank God we got somebody inside of us now, and we know what he done for us. Know where he found us, where he picked us up, how he changed us. I don't want to waste what God gives me. I'm glad I'm an heir and a joint heir to all that he has. Amen. I'm glad my God can supply all your needs according to his riches and glory. How rich is it, friend? He owns it all. All of it's mine. Amen. Amen. Father's foot care. Here he comes in. He's got a dirty, stinking, bleeding feet. And we know that if you study, a barefooted in that day meant shame. It meant a slave. Jesus died for our shame, amen. He died with his shoes off, friend, when they nailed him to the cross. I think about it. Listen to me, friend. Listen. Here's a young man that's in shame, friend. Moses came to the mount, friend. Moses tried to do it in the flesh and he failed. God said, take your shoes off. Take your shoes off on holy ground. Moses, your shame. Got to take his shoes off. At night I come to him with all my shame, with all my slavery. I'm glad, thank God, he put some shoes on me that night. Shod me with the preparation of the gospel, amen. Saved me by the grace of God. He took my shame when he went to Calvary and nailed it to the cross. I think about the Father's fellowship, amen. All through that chapter, it talks about rejoicing, rejoicing, rejoicing. I'm rejoicing in the presence of the angel. Who do you think that is, friend? Thank God, there's some saints that's already crossed over. I'm rejoicing in the presence of the angel. I can't find any. Some folks said, I heard preachers years ago said, they're looking out over the battlements of glory. That's a bunch of hogwash, friend. They wouldn't enjoy heaven looking down here at all this hellish mess going on. Oh, they're looking at him. But I believe, listen, you ain't but one long day over there anyway. Ain't no nighttime over there. I was preaching a meeting one time. I know we'll forget this. God kind of showed me this while I was preaching that night. He was preaching this church, and I was at the old saint of God. Every time you go to church, you say, pray for my boy. Pray for my grandboy. Pray for my boy. I mean, weeping and broken and crying. Pray for my boy. Pray for my grandson. Pray for my son. Pray for my grandson. She died. They weren't saved. Revival meeting up one night, that boy was there. Her son, he got saved by the grace of God. The meeting was supposed to close out that night. He begged the preacher. He never said anything. He begged the preacher, said, let's go one more night. If you go another night, I'll shut my business down. I'll beg everybody to come to church. Next night, he brought his son down. That boy got in that satanic stuff, had hair down here, all that gothic stuff. That looked like his face running to a tackle box. I mean, he was in a mess. Come in with a smirky smile on him. His daddy told him God had saved him. God was on the mountain, friend. And he made fun of his daddy. He said, I'll go over there and show you how big your God is. He come at night, sit over on a pew, just a smiling and a smirking. Before the end of the night was over, it was gone, friend. His whole countenance changed. Somebody picked around in him, bigger than a little preacher, amen. He didn't get saved that night, so somebody else stood up and said, please go one more night. That's going to close the meeting down. Had a boy come back next night, brought his girlfriend, looked worse than him. Listen, the house was packed, running over. That girl walked the back of the pew that night, come running down the aisle and fell on the altar like he shot in the back of the head with a gun, saying, I don't want to go to hell. I don't want to go. She looked worse than him. She got saved. Here, come down the aisle. Just the tears are dripping. Got saved by the grace of God. And God, by the next night, had already cut that much of his house. I'm talking about him one night. He ain't heard no preaching about that. But thank God, I'm glad God's big enough. I had to turn the light on and save sinners by the grace of God. Listen, friend, we've got to believe God can do it again, amen. We've got to believe it. I believe this, and this is when God showed me that scripture. Grandma wanted that at night. Mama wanted that service at night. But I said, she just found out about it. Amen. And I'm talking about, she just went and shouting down here. And she got, I can't imagine what she's like over there. When she found out about that boy and grandboy, she spent most of her life praying over them babies, amen. And both of them got in. One got in one night and one the next night. I'm sure that's thank God rejoicing in the presence of angels. Hey, I thank God there's some angels around here tonight, amen. It ought to be some rejoicing around here in the presence. Had four souls saved last week, amen. That's enough to shout about, amen. Thank God it used to cause us to cut cartwheels and run around the building a time or two. But listen, friend, we've got some decisions we made about disasters in our life, amen. We forgot about the power of God, what he can do. Father's fellowship. Now think about this, friend. That stall-fed calf. He'd been feeding him every day, I believe, talking to him. I'm looking for my boy to come. Hey, man, I'm looking for my boy to come. I tell people this jokingly, but it could be true. If that prodigal would have ate in them hogs at the hog lot, he might not have ever tasted the fatted calf. There's some folks out there in the world, if they taste certain things out there, they may not make it back. They may not make it back. But I said, oh, dear God, I'll be honest with y'all. I wrestled all day. I feel like I got some messages lined up this weekend and throughout all day today. But I really had to seek God. But God would not let me get away from this for some reason. And I believe this is what God has said. If you'll come this week and let me make you, don't ask me to give. Just come and say, this week, I want you to make me. I believe before the week is over, I believe he'll bring the fatted calf out and we can have a time. Amen. I believe we'll have a good time. I believe God will feed us a little meat around here. Grab some steaks, thank God, out of heaven. Amen. Then we can eat on a little fatted calf. Amen. We ought to be sick and tired of the swine of this world and just going through the routine and the rut. I only want God to bring the calf out of the stall. It's one thing for you to run this week. If we can get him to run in this week. If he'd come in here and run up down these pews a little bit. We get God running up down the pews, still a little preacher. God start running up in these pews here. And God, you might get up and run a little bit, amen. I love to see some of y'all embarrassed, stinking rotten flesh, amen. We've sat around, we got so dignified. I got our padded pews, our fancy clothes, everything just forgot about when we was over yonder tomb with no clothes. Didn't have any money, didn't have anywhere to live, didn't even have any hope, didn't have a friend. At the bottom of the barrel in the hog lot, ain't you glad God came by and picked you up out of the muck and the mire? Fatted calf. God's got it ready. You think he's got to stay up all day today and tonight and work on having a revival ready? Huh? You think he's got to wring his hand tonight? What if I can feed my youngins? What if he can feed the birds another day? Huh? Hey man, if God can do all that, what do you think he could do for this hand for tonight? Ain't got all them millions out trying to, ain't got the shoes didn't wear out. They didn't have to worry about bread and quail. Ain't got, listen, we're not coming here this week. I'm worried about, well, just trust God, amen. Some discoveries ought to be made this week. How big God is. Amen. Think about this. Father's fellowship. He's gone from the Father's house, but he never left his heart. Some of y'all may have been and gone a little bit in your fellowship, but you ain't left his heart. He's got you on his heart tonight. If we could get him on our heart. Had a boys over y'all and everybody's turned their back on him. They said, you know what? I saw how good my father took care of them servants over there. They had more bread than they could eat. They even had bread to spare. So if I can just go back over there and be one of his slaves, he don't have to call me son no more. If we'd ever get to the place where we said, God, if you just let me be your bond slave, your servant, you know what he'll do every time? He'll say, I'm going to do something better than that. I'll make you a son. Huh? Hey, man, I don't know what that does for y'all, but I'm glad I'm in the family. I ain't wondering about it. I ain't worried about it. I didn't know what all I got that night. When he adopted me in the family. That means he's got to take care of me from now on. Amen. I belong to him. Amen. Amen. And listen, I thank God that God can pull the fatted calf out. That we can have fellowship this week. Thank God the Bible says there in verse number 24. Look what it says in verse 24. How for this my son was dead. He's dead. You might have one of your boys, you got a son die this week. And God literally raised him from the dead and then come back to church. What you reckon you'd do? You reckon you'd sit there? You reckon you wouldn't get up and talk a little bit? Yes, sir. Huh? See, he's dead. My boy's dead. Look what he said. But he's alive again. Ain't that revival? Yes, sir. Been alive again. Huh? Yeah. Been alive again. Look what he said. He was lost. I'm glad I don't get lost, though. I don't get lost. He said he's found. But look what he said. And they began to be what? To be merry. Thank God, God's people ought to be merry people, amen. All through that chapter, they rejoice, they rejoice, they rejoice. That's what separates us from the world, amen. We know who we are. We know where we come from. We know where we're going. We know what God's doing for us. We rejoice. The Bible said they began. Did y'all see that? I don't see no end there. There's no end there. When we get him rejoicing. And we're to keep on rejoicing. Why did I rejoice the day I got in? Because I got introduced to the Savior. I got born again, I got saved. Thank God I'm just as saved tonight as I was that night. I'll be just as saved tomorrow as I am today, friend. It makes me love him more and more and more when God ought to put his foot on my neck. Huh? Hell have thumped all us in hell a long time ago. But what does he do every day? I think somebody started kissing on y'all, think you might feel a little something, don't you think? Huh? I didn't get saved on feelings, I got saved on facts. I put my faith in the facts, amen. But it sure has felt good ever since I found out about the facts, amen. Thank God I've been feeling good ever since. And so verse 24, the fullness that he sought. Right at the house, amen. He had all that he needed all the time. Folks are leaving church. They're leaving church. No, ain't no time to leave church. Oh, I know all hell's breaking loose. I know the hog lots are full. But he's got all that we need at the house. At the house. At the Father's house. He's living in the Father's presence. Only be in his presence. He's also in the Father's love. He's doing the Father's will. It brings happiness. You want to be happy? You want to have joy? Do the Father's will. First time you done his will, he's not willing that any should perish. So I got saved. It brought joy to him, brought joy to me. And every day I want to step where he wants me to step, it brings joy to him, brings joy to me. Huh? Thank God, is that right or not? And so this week, what I want to do is say, Lord, I don't want you to give me nothing. I want you to make me. You can make me. I believe once he make us, I believe he'll make us merry. He ain't going to make me miserable. He don't make you. The devil makes folks miserable. God makes people merry. You'd be so merry if you start eating on some of that fatted calf this week. If he bring the fatted calf out tonight or tomorrow night and we eat on that calf all week long, you know what you want to do next week? You want to eat some more of it. Amen. And we want some more of it. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. I'm talking about the heartbeat of heaven. Amen. It's lost to man being saved by the grace of God. Thank God for the Son coming. Died on the old rugged cross that you and I could have life, have it more abundantly. Thank God for the Holy Spirit of God that brought conviction to my soul. Proved me guilty that I could be saved. Thank God for the Father. And his arms open wide. When the lost said, put your foot on his neck and cast him into hell. He said, no, I'm going to get down there and kiss on him. Amen. And reconcile him. Amen. A pardon. Father says his will, his authority is where you find true happiness. I got more than I asked for. I got more than that. You know, when I went that night, I don't know all I said. I don't know what all I prayed. I don't, Dad, if anybody in here, you were so tore up. Now, I don't know what happened to y'all. It don't happen the same way to everybody, but you get saved the same way. I've been to church. I've been to church before. I thought they was crazy. See, back in and shout and praise God. They didn't sit around me like statues and mad folks. Folks sit around like they're mad all the time now. I come to church with a chip on and keep it on while they're there and they take it back with them if you don't knock it off. If they stay around preaching long enough, we're going to knock it off. Amen. We get knocked off if they stay around preaching long enough. But they come in rejoicing. They leave out rejoicing. The choir, I mean, they sung. Everybody sung. They didn't sit there like. They let a rip. They sung. They waved their hands. All of them had handkerchiefs waving. Men would run around. You say, I know you wouldn't, but they did. Because there's Mary. There's rejoicing. Huh? I said, man, they're all crazy and they'd be locked up. But there was something pulling me back out. He might come back, old preacher, preach again. And he'd preach. I'm sure he's plowing somebody's row, but somehow the Holy Ghost didn't let it get on me too close. But then it come my night. Huh? And it was all for me. Every time he shot, it was right at me. I looked around to see if there's any more pews back there. But the Holy Ghost had zeroed in on me. And I'll tell you one thing, he hung me out of hell. And I don't know if y'all can believe it or not. Before I ever knew anything about Cora and him, I felt like the building was about to fall into hell. That's how convicted I was. That's how proven guilty I was. I couldn't get saved fast enough. I run as fast as a boy can run at that altar. Hey, man, as fast. I didn't walk, I run. I ran. Unashamedly, I ran as fast as I could go and fell on my face before God to get saved by the grace of God. Amen. Listen, friend, if I'd ever get a time that we'd come and let God make us this week. You come here next Sunday so happy, rejoicing, praising God. Everybody on the same page, shouting, praising God. He might have a heart attack. You'd call, come on back, preach a funeral. So he'd be rejoicing over that. I'm just telling you. And don't you long see your people rejoicing in Jesus? Happy in the Lord, happy in the Lord. Man, go to church like killing you. I mean, like it's killing folk to go to church. I don't come to get out. I come get in. I'm in church about every night now. I didn't say, boy, I got to go to church. I said, I can't wait to see what God's going to do tonight. Yes, I mean, I can't wait to see what he's going to do tonight, tomorrow night, next night. I'm looking for God to do something. I believe we got to do like this, boy. We got to get up. Move toward him. He's already got it. He's already got the calf. It's ready. He's already got it. He's got it ready. Y'all hear me? He's already got it ready. All we got to do is come and say, make me. I'm done. Chris, play something softly.